The learning objectives of this chapter are that you will be aware of the contaminants found in crude oil, be aware of the contaminants that can result from the refining process, be aware of the contaminants that can result from transport and storage of marine fuel oils, be aware of the contaminant removal methods available, and have a knowledge of the effect of the main contaminants on plant operation. Contaminants in marine fuel oil can be considered to be any non-hydrocarbon elements, compounds or materials present in the fuel. We have already discussed many of these when we considered the content of ISO 8217, and you should be familiar with them by now. In this chapter, we will look at the sources of these contaminants and see if we can do anything about them. As you are now aware, crude oil is a mixture of compounds, most of which are hydrocarbon-based. Some of these hydrocarbon compounds also contain other chemical elements within the chemical structure. These elements include metals such as vanadium, nickel and iron, and non-metals such as sodium and silicon, along with many others. There are also other contaminants in the crude which are not chemically attached to the hydrocarbons. These include sand, water, trace metals and soil as examples. The exact chemical makeup of the crude oil and the nature of the contaminants found in it varies depending on the source of the crude oil. As an example, crude oil from Mexico and Venezuela tend to have high vanadium content. Crude oil from Saudi Arabia and Iraq tend to have low sulfur content. The main purpose of refining is to convert crude oil, with its limited use, to products which are more useful and hence of greater value. During the refining process, any chemical contamination of the original crude structure is concentrated in the residue, as the pure hydrocarbon product is drawn off. Since these residues are the basis for the heavy marine fuels in use today, then the contaminant levels are inherently high. Some of the refining processes also introduce contaminants into the fuel. We have already discussed the problem associated with aluminium and silicon content of the fuel and identified the source as being the catalyst in the refining process. The products from the refining process, including marine fuel oils, are transported by a wide range of methods. This may be done by pipeline, by road, by sea, or in some cases by rail. All of these transport methods carry some degree of risk as far as contamination of the fuel oil is concerned. The pipes may be corroded. The roll and rail tankers may have carried a different product, and the oil tanker may have been loaded with different material. All of these may result in dirt, rust, water, or other material contaminating the product. If the fuel is stored in a container or tank which previously held other materials, then this can lead to contamination. Tank farms, as the storage facilities are often referred to, usually have interconnecting piping arrangements between the various tanks. Valve leakage or incorrect valve position can lead to cross-contamination. This is no different to your situation on board ship, where there are often cross-connections between different systems. Another problem which you may encounter, particularly when using distillate fuels, is contamination by microbes. Certain microbes can exist in distillate fuel tanks when water is present. The microbes form colonies, which collect together as slimy masses, which can be corrosive. The slime can also result in blockage of fuel filter. You will often detect the presence by the slimy deposits and foul smell. Once you have received the fuel on board, you will first store, then transfer, and pre-treat it before actually using it. This gives a whole new range of contamination opportunities, but at least now you will have some direct control over the situation. Think about some of the contamination risks on board. Dirty bunker lines. Dirty bunker tanks, ingress of seawater through faulty vent or sounding pipes, leakage between tanks, faulty filters breaking up, poor separator operation, allowing sealing water to pass out with fuel, incorrect dosage of treatment chemicals. These are just some possibilities. You can probably think of more. The effect of contaminated fuel on the operation of the machinery and the ship could be anything from a minor inconvenience to a major disaster. We have talked about some of the types of damage that can be caused to the engine in an earlier chapter. Just to remind you, some of these are listed here. Cold corrosion, hot corrosion, abrasive wear, loss of cylinder lubrication, and fouling of exhaust systems. Contamination of fuel may affect the combustion process, which can lead to damage because of high pressures or high temperatures. It can also lead to heavy fouling, which may result in uptake fires or scavenge fires. Severe contamination may make the fuel totally unusable, so that the engine cannot be operated, putting the ship at risk. To ensure that problems and damage are kept to a minimum when using fuel, you need to be aware of the contaminants that are present, and the best methods available to remove them. Although the fuel standard will indicate the limit values for many of the parameters, you will want to know the actual values before using the fuel. You should be given a delivery note when the fuel is bunkered, which gives specific values for the parameters. To check that this is accurate will require that you have the fuel analyzed. Many of the classification societies and some specialist companies offer a detailed analysis service. It is also good practice to carry out some simple onboard tests to get an early indication of any problems with the specification or the presence of any contaminants. Using onboard tests will allow you to check the main parameters, such as density and viscosity, in addition to giving an indication of the presence of water and abrasives. The best way to remove water is by regularly draining it from settling and service tanks. The fuel should then be passed through a centrifuge, set up as a purifier, or through an automatic coalescing filter module. Coarse, solid particles can be removed by passing the fuel through strainers and filters. The finer particles can be removed by centrifuging. For high levels of solids contamination, it may be necessary to pass the fuel through a purifier and then a clarifier. Some fuel systems include a homogenizer, which is used to mix up the fuel and break down some of the solids. Manual cleaning of fuel tanks is also necessary to prevent accumulation of sludge and debris. The various methods of pretreatment are covered in detail in CBT number 10, Marine Fuel Handling and Pretreatment. There are a number of chemical additives available which can be used to condition the fuel, to minimize problems and improve performance, and some can be quite effective. If you are unfortunate enough to experience microbial problems with your fuel, you will need to use biocides to get rid of them. This can be an ongoing problem, as the microbes often reappear after treatment. The best way is to avoid them altogether by ensuring distillate tanks are kept water-free. The various chemical treatments are covered in CBT number 10, Marine Fuel Handling and Pre-Treatment.